So we have already seen that the work energy principle for a rigid body is essentially same as for a particle, right? So W is defined as delta T, where W can be further subdivided into work done by internal forces plus work done by external forces equal to change in kinetic energy. And we've already seen what the expression for kinetic energy for rigid bodies moving in a plane looks like. So work done by internal forces. In general, the work done by internal forces is not zero, but on a single rigid body, the work done by internal forces is actually equal to zero, because the particles or the differential elements on the rigid bodies don't move relative to each other. So if you take, let's say, an element Pi and another element Pj, and you know, I could say element or I could say particle, because this applies for a system of particles as well, where the particles are not allowed to move with respect to each other. Okay, so strictly speaking, rigid bodies are not system of particles. They should be modeled as a continuum medium, but for all practical purposes, you can definitely think of them as system particles, where the particles don't move with respect to each other. So let's say we have an internal force Fij exerted on Pi by Pj, and the same internal force is exerted on Pj by Pi. So Fij is equal to minus Fji. So the question is the work done by Fij and the Fji cancel each other out? So let's say Pi, it has a displacement dri, and Pj has a displacement drj, and these are differential displacement. So the work done on Pi is equal to integral Fij dot dri. And notice we are only talking about internal forces. We know that external forces do non-zero work in general. So that's on Pi. On Pj, it is minus integral Fij dot drj. Why minus Fij? Because you have Fgi, which is equal to minus Fij. So if we add these two, what do we get? So WWPI plus WPJ is equal to Fij integral dot DRI minus DRJ. Now for a rigid body in general, this quantity may not be zero, right? Because if you have, let's say, a rigid body rotating, you know, one point would be moving more distance than another point, which may be closer to the axis of rotation. So in general, this is not going to be zero. So this work done is not zero because this quantity is zero, right? But we can write this slightly differently in the following way. Integral Fij dot DRI minus DRJ divided by DT times DT. So I'm just multiplying by DT and dividing by DT. So this becomes integral Fij dot velocity of I minus velocity of J, right? Because DRI over DT is velocity of I and DRJ over DT is velocity of J times DT. This quantity itself is nothing but omega cross R of I with respect to J, right? So R of I with J is this vector going from here to here. That's R of I with respect to J, okay? Because this is the relative velocity formula for two points on the same rigid body that is rotating with angular velocity omega, right? Okay, so what is this quantity? Omega cross R of I with respect to J is the velocity which is going to be perpendicular to this vector, right? Because we're doing a cross product. So this quantity is really perpendicular to, depending on which way omega is pointing. If omega is going this way, then the velocity will be that way. If omega is going counterclockwise, it will be that way. But basically, it's a line, it's pointing along a line that's perpendicular to Fij, right? Which means that Fij dotted with Vi minus Vj would be equal to zero, because those two vectors are pointing in perpendicular directions. And that means the work done by internal forces on a rigid body will not do any work. But that is not to say that if you have a system of rigid bodies and they're moving relative to each other, then the work done by internal forces would still be zero. Okay, on a single rigid body, the internal forces are not doing any work whatsoever. Now let's look at work done on rigid bodies by forces and couples, right? So couples are also known as torques or moments, okay? So work done by forces, definition is still same, there's no difference. that's integral f dot dr. So if you know the force applied, you know the displacement of the point where the force is applied, then you take the dot product between the two and you can compute the work done, right? So if you have, you know, five different forces acting on a rigid body, you look at the point of application of those forces on the rigid body, you track how far the particles move and how far the points move on the rigid body and how they move, and you look at the force and do the dot product and you can compute the work done. Work done by couple, let's compute that. You know, you could not never do a work due to a couple on a particle because particle has no size and shape, but now on a rigid body you can do that. So let's say I have a point and I have a point B and I apply a force FA that way and I apply the same force FB. Okay, so magnitude of FA is of course equal to magnitude of FB. Okay, and let's say we have, you know, a distance between A and B, and this line is of course perpendicular to the point of application of the force. Okay, so let's say this particular vector over here going from B to A is R of A with B. Then the moment itself can be written as R of A with B cross FA. So this is the moment of the force FA about point B. And this is also equal to, if you take the moment about point A, as R of B with A cross FB, right? So if you compute the work done by FA and FB, let's say differential displacement of point A is, you know, DRA, and the differential displacement of point B is DRB, then the work done is equal to integral FA dot DRA plus integral FB dot DRB. And since FB is equal to minus FA, we get integral FA dot DRA minus DRB. And as we have done before, we'll divide by DT and multiply by DT because we want to get the velocity relationship. So you get this dot VA minus VB dot times DT not dot. VA minus VB is equal to omega cross R of A, which is B. So let's write that. This is dot omega cross R of A with respect to B. So omega is the angular velocity of the rigid body, right? And then we still have dt on this side. Okay, so this can be written as, so this is actually A dot B cross C. So what we'll do is we'll use an identity. A dot B cross C is equal to B dot C cross A. Okay, so B is omega, so we'll write omega dot R of A, which is B, cross FA. Okay, now this quantity, what is this? This is nothing but the moment, right? Which is what we wrote over here. So let's substitute that, and we get integral omega dot moment dt. Moment is pointing in a direction perpendicular to the plane where position vectors are lying and the forces are lying. So this can be written as mk hat. And omega can be written as omega k hat, assuming that both of them are pointing in the positive direction. So we get simply m times omega dt. But omega is nothing but theta dot, which is d theta over dt. So this will be integral m d theta over dt times dt. Dt cancels, and we get integral m d theta. So what we find is that the work done by a moment or a couple is simply integral m d theta. But this expression is valid only if moment is acting in a direction perpendicular to the motion of the plane. So remember, this is all valid only for a rigid body moving in a plane. And you can see that this expression over here is kind of similar to what we have for the work done for due to a force. For a work done due to a force, we have integral f dot dr. So we have force and we have the displacement, linear displacement. Here we have a couple and we have angular displacement. Which means that now if you know the moment applied on a rigid body, and you know the amount of rotation that rigid body has undergone, then you can compute what the work done would be. So let me give you a simple example. Let's say I have a gear, okay? I have a gear, and this gear is being rotated by a motor, okay? And this motor is applying a torque, whatever that might be, is applying a torque. And this torque applied on the gear by the motor results into, I don't know, let's say n revolutions, okay? So n revolutions. Could be 1000 revolutions or something like that. And the question is, to rotate this gear by n revolutions, what is the work done by this torque? So the work done would be equal to integral m d theta. Since this moment or the torque applied is constant, so let's put some numbers. So let's say torque is 5 Newton meter and n is equal to 100 revolutions. Okay, so 100 revolutions. And then this would be equal to integral 5 d theta. 5 is constant, we'll take it outside. Integral d theta is nothing but theta, right? And this has to be always written in radians. So don't make the mistake of writing this in actual degree. So if it is 100 revolutions, so theta would be 100 times 2 pi, right? That would be the in radians. So we'll get what, 500 times 2, that's 1000 times pi joules. And that's the work done by the motor on the gear in rotating this gear by 100 revolutions. So in this case, you will notice that the moment or the torque applied was constant with theta, so we could take it outside. But if you are given moment as a function of theta, then you would have to do an integration. So if I said that the torque applied is, let's say, theta squared plus 3 theta cubed Newton meter, and this is clearly a function of theta, and I say compute the work done by this moment, then you will write integral m d theta, which will be integral theta squared plus 3 theta cubed d theta, and that will be equal to theta cubed over 3 plus 3 theta 4 over 4, and then you would apply your, you know, limits. So theta max 0 to theta max, and theta max for 100 revolution would be 100 times 2 pi in radians. Now this particular expression may not be very practical. In fact, it may be very hard to find a motor or any device that can actually provide this kind of torque, but this is just hypothetically speaking, purely an academic exercise. So while this moment function may not be very practical, there is another moment function of theta which is actually quite practical, and that is the work done by a torsional spring. So if you have, let's say, you know, a torsional spring, you know, which looks like this, and you attach this spring to a rod, right? And you know, this rod is constrained to rotate about, you know, center, and that's where you have the torsional spring. Then as you rotate this, okay, the torsional spring basically gets engaged, gets loaded, okay? So if, let's say, this rod rotates by an angle theta, then the torsional spring applies a moment on the rod in the opposite direction of the motion. So this isn't much different from a linear spring. Which is attached to a particle, and if this particle is pushed in this direction and the particle displaces by amount x from equilibrium, then on the particle there is a force applied in the opposite direction of the motion, which is proportional to the displacement, right? So this force is actually in the opposite direction of the motion. Same thing with the torsional spring. If you rotate this in the counterclockwise direction, then the torque applied is in the opposite direction. So assuming that theta is positive in the counterclockwise direction, then the moment is proportional to theta, and it's in the opposite direction, so we write it as minus k sub t theta to indicate that this is actually the torsional coefficient. Okay, so that's the moment applied on this rigid body in the opposite direction. So if I wanted to compute the work done by this moment, which is clearly a function of theta, I could do that. Work done is integral m d theta, so this is minus k t theta d theta. So kt comes outside, so this becomes theta squared over 2, going from theta 1 to theta 2. So this is actually minus 1 half k sub t theta squared minus 1 half k sub t theta 1 squared. Now you can see in this case that the work done actually doesn't depend on the actual path, right? Just like the work done due to gravity or the elastic forces didn't depend on the path taken by the particle, right? We are only concerned with the final and initial position of this spring, which means that we can express this as change in potential energy, where u can be written as 1 half k sub t theta squared, right? So this is also minus delta u. So if you have a torsional spring attached to a rigid body and you were trying to compute the work done by that, you could definitely write that in terms of change in potential energy function. Another minor point is to see how we write down the work done by gravity on a rigid body. So why is this important? Because for a rigid body, you have infinite number of particles on the rigid body. So when you compute the work done by gravity, we know that it is expressed by the potential energy function, which is mg times y, where y is the distance from the datum, vertical distance from the datum to a particular point. So for a particle, there is only one point. For a rigid body, there are infinite points. So which point should you pick? So the point that we pick to compute the potential energy due to gravity is actually the center of mass. Okay, so which means that if you have, let's say, a rigid body here, here is the center of mass, and this is your datum, then the potential energy in this position would be y1. Okay, and if this moved from here to here, let's say in this configuration, and this is where the center of mass was, then you would pick the vertical distance from the datum to the center of mass as, let's say, y2, and that would give you the work done, which is minus delta u equal to minus u2 minus u1, and u1 would be mg y1, and u2 would be mg y2. So this also tells you that if you take the rigid body and rotate it about center of mass, its potential energy function due to gravity, which is mgy, wouldn't change, right? So if I take the same rigid body, and here is the center of mass, and I rotate this to a new configuration about center of mass, then y1 and y2 are same, right? And that means delta u in this case would be zero.